All right, how are we doing today? Awesome. Man, that's just a little vignette of one of my favorite songs right now. If you haven't heard it, it's called Fierce by Jesus Culture. Download that song and just play it on repeat until you get tired of it. And that's what I've been doing. I haven't gotten tired of it yet. I'm kind of that guy that just wears out a song, though. If I like it, it's just always on repeat. And it's just been growing my spirit, my faith this week as I've been listening to that song and remembering just how huge our God is. Now, I don't know what you're facing today and what you're walking through. I don't know the context of life and the unique dynamics that each of you face, but I want to just encourage you today that we serve a really big God, right? And it's tough sometimes. I mean, it's easy to understand that, you know, in theory, to have an academic understanding that God is big, but it's difficult sometimes when you're facing real life situations and you just don't seem to see God doing what you would like to see him do, right? And man, we live in a world, a culture that is desperately needing God to show up on their behalf. And as you look around you every single day, it's not just a personal thing in you, but there's people out there as well who need the love of God to invade their life. And we have this great opportunity as believers who've put our faith, our trust in Jesus Christ, to release the power of God into a culture that is quite godless. To take the hope of Christ that's within us and to release it to the world. Colossians 1:27, Pastor Brett even mentioned it, it says Christ in us, right? The hope of glory. And think about that. I mean, growing up in church a lot of years and being around church, you know, there were times in my life where God kind of felt distant. He felt almost abstract and far out there. And man, as I've like surrendered my life to Jesus and allowed him to be Lord of my life, something has shifted. To where God no longer feels far and he no longer feels distant, but I've this understanding that he lives in me. Think about that idea, that the God of the universe, all-powerful God, I mean, he's in you. It's not this abstract, far out there thing. God of the universe is in you and he's in me. And Colossians, Paul writes, he says, it's the hope of the world. It's the hope of the world. And I don't know, as you look around, man, there are situations and circumstances people face day after day after day. I mean, in our church and outside of our church, we live in a culture that needs an authentic encounter with Jesus. And I've been wondering lately, to what degree do I have responsibility in presenting Jesus to a world that desperately needs him? There is a lot of people, right? And everywhere you look, man, there are marriages that are crumbling. There are relationships that are falling apart. You, man, it's just as much happening with inside the church as it is outside of the church. Marriages that are just in desperate need, hopeless situations. There are children who are in deep rebellion. Man, there are people who are going to the doctor and they're getting these hopeless diagnoses, man. There's sickness and ailment and infirmity, you know, flooding through their body, and everything seems hopeless. And I've been reminded lately, as God has been stirring my heart, God has been stirring new things in me. How many of you know that it's important for God to do new things in you? That you cannot just live on yesterday's manna, right? That you have to have something fresh today. You have to have something fresh tomorrow. And something God has been doing in me lately is I'm trying to bring myself to a place where I really believe that God's as big as he says he is. That he really can do the things that I read about in Scripture. And it's great to read stories. It's great to have stories that anchor our faith. But what I've been telling Pastor Brett and Pastor Wes on our trip together is I said, man, I am so hungry to have our own stories. I don't just want to read about stuff that happened one time. I don't just want to read about something that is a historical event. I want to start telling stories that began to happen here in our church and in our lives, and people began to meet God in a powerful way, and their lives were changed. And God stirred me up to believe that he can start doing that again. And it starts by presenting the hope of the world to people who are in hopeless situations. It starts by knowing what is in us and what we have access to. You know, sometimes like we forget what we have access to. And it's interesting, you know, because you're a son or you're a daughter of the Most High God. I mean, you realize that. And we sometimes forget like what we have access to. I remember growing up in church as my dad was a pastor, and I remember having in his office, the top drawer, he had all this candy. It was this stash. And because I was his son, I had access to his stash. But man, there were other kids in the church that heard about the stash, but they couldn't just go in and get it whenever they wanted. I don't know that I could either, but I did. No, he let us. But there is something about being a son that gives you access to things that other people don't have access to. There's something about being a child, a daughter of the Most High God that gives you access to things that other people do not have access to. And it is important for us to start living this thing out the way it's meant to be. I just think every day, every single day, somebody needs you to step out so that they could meet Jesus. Think about that. Every day, every single day, somebody needs us to step out so that they could meet Jesus. That's a tough thing to swallow sometimes. It's like, man, how does that work? How do I do that? I can't do that at work. I can't live this way. Bill Johnson says it like this: any gospel that doesn't work in the marketplace doesn't work. Like this thing goes with us. It doesn't just stop at the door. It's who we are. I can't shut off who I am. It doesn't mean that I'm this crazy psycho standing on a corner, you know, preaching hellfire to everybody that drives by, but it means that I know what I have access to and I know whose I am. And I bring that with me. My identity doesn't change just because I walk into an environment that doesn't embrace Jesus. I'm still a son when I walk into an environment that doesn't embrace Jesus. I still have access to the same things I had access to. And that's kind of the idea I want to unpack today in the book of Daniel. And you find that Daniel is a young man who is taken captive, and he's brought to the Babylonian Empire, to the city of Babylon, which in that day would have been one of the most wicked places on the planet. It would have been the epicenter of idolatry, the epicenter of, you know, the worshiping to other gods. And in fact, you know, if you think of like empires that have, you know, existed in history, it's one of the most godless, wicked empires that has ever existed on the planet. And you know, just some geographical understanding that the city of Babylon, its ruins, where it was located, is just south of Baghdad in Iraq. I always think that stuff's interesting. There are strongholds and things that remain when they're not dealt with. And it proceeds to generation after generation after generation. And so we find Daniel is a young man who is taken captive because the children of Israel had come into a season where they had given themselves to wickedness. They had had a godly king, and his son took over. Jehoiakim was the king, and he gave the nation over to idolatry and the worshiping of other gods, and it made God angry, and he allowed them to be conquered and brought out in captivity to the city of Babylon. Isn't it interesting that the very thing that got them entangled in sin, they were brought to the place in the world that was the epicenter for those very things that they had been doing wrong? And so in 605 BC, when Jerusalem was conquered, Daniel is brought out of Jerusalem with his friends. You know him as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and they're brought to Babylon. A few years later, there's another siege on Jerusalem, and tens of thousands of Hebrew people are brought as captives back to the Babylonian Empire. One of those guys is Ezekiel, who wrote another book in the Old Testament. And so we find he's a contemporary, you know, ministering and operating really at the same time that Daniel was. You find, too, that a few years later, they finally conquered the entire city and burned the temple of God to the ground. And Nebuchadnezzar, one of the most evil, godless kings of all time. I mean, it's quite a legacy. He burns the temple to the ground, and then he takes artifacts from the temple, and he brings them out of the temple and takes them back with him to Babylon and places these important religious Jewish artifacts in the temple of his false pagan god as a mockery and a pure embarrassment to show them that their god isn't as big as they thought he was. And so these people are conquered. They are now living in a foreign land, and Daniel is one of them. And he writes this book, and he writes it in two languages. He starts writing the book in Hebrew, and then he switches and writes the majority of the rest of the book in Aramaic before he switches back and finishes the book in Hebrew again. It's a book divided really into two themes. The first half of the book is these great stories that we've heard about in Sunday school, right? The big ones, the lion's den, you know, the fiery furnaces, the handwriting on the wall, you know, visions and dreams miraculously interpreted. That's kind of the first half. And then the second half of the book, it really changes focus and theme as it really is more God giving Daniel prophetic visions and dreams about what is to come. And so we find that this book is a great book for understanding, you know, future events. In fact, it also helps us to interpret and understand other portions of Scripture. I don't know if any of you have ever been, excited by the book of Revelation. It really scares me more than anything. I value it, but it's a little crazy read. I don't try to read it right before I go to bed, or I see like monsters and things. But I'm like, whoa, God, wow. But anybody ever like read through Revelation? I mean, you can just wave your hand in the air. Yeah, okay. I don't know if you knew this, but it's nearly impossible to really gain an accurate understanding of the events in the book of Revelation apart from the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel, the second half of the book of Daniel, really is a resource. It's source material that really complements the book of Revelation and helps you gain a greater understanding of what God's really trying to reveal to us through that incredible prophetic vision that John had in Revelation. And so I want to jump in a little more to this book, and I want to break open Daniel chapter 1. If you've got your Bibles, you can just throw your thumb there. And we're going to talk a little bit about this book and how significant it is for us. There's this big idea I want you to catch. You see, I start thinking about the book of Daniel, especially like when we started talking about how interesting it would be to teach on this book at church for a number of weeks. And I started immediately, you know, you start thinking of the huge grandiose stories. I'm like, man, that's Daniel, and this is Daniel. How could he, man, I mean, all this stuff and miraculous things happening in the book. And yet I think there's a greater theme that kind of weaves its way throughout the book of Daniel, and it's this idea. The book of Daniel really serves as a template for how to live and thrive in a godless culture. That's really what it is. Because Daniel was from Jerusalem. He was from the nation of God. And he had great belief that God was huge. And as he's brought to a very wicked, godless nation, godless culture, there's really this tension that begins to surmount. It's this idea that he would either adapt to the culture around them or he would choose to invade the culture. And there was something significant that happened in Daniel. He loved God enough that he knew that even though he was away from where he was from, that he could still bring the presence of God and that people could still see how great his God was in a land that was godless and wicked. I have this thought lately that it's like we owe the world an encounter with God. I don't know if you think about that, like we owe the world like an encounter with Jesus.
like everywhere we go, right? People are waiting for us to step out. They're waiting for us to be who we say we are. And it's also that they could meet Jesus, perhaps for the first time. But so many times, like, I think we feel so powerless. We feel like, you know, it's some of the stuff that Pastor Brett's been talking about is, man, I've grown up in church and I've heard all these things about God, but so much of it I've not really experienced the way the Bible lays it out. I read of these things, I read of the greatness of God, the bigness of God. And man, God has been stirring me. I've been saying, man, people deserve an encounter with God when they come in contact with me, and I better start believing God for greater things. It's interesting, you know, the Bible says that if we keep quiet, the stones, the rocks will cry out. Let me tell you right now, you're never gonna find a rock that will outpraise me. Right? Ever. So let's open this up. Daniel chapter 1. It says in verse 1, it says, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it, and the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with some of the vessels of the house of God, and he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and placed the vessels in the treasury of his God. Right? We talked through some of that. Just a complete mockery, you know, of everything they were. So Nebuchadnezzar's this evil king, right? He doesn't just destroy their city, but he burns their temple as well. It says in verse 3, then the king commanded Ashpenaz, his chief eunuch. I've always wondered why that, you know, why do you have to like make that an important detail in scripture, you know? Like why do we need to know that? And it's like, okay. But it's interesting, the only people who could work and serve in the court of the king by law had to be eunuchs. And so that's just an important reason, I guess, why they have to tell us that. So he commanded Ashpenaz to bring some of the people of Israel, both of the royal family and of the nobility, youths, catch this, youths without blemish, of good appearance and skillful in all wisdom, endowed with knowledge, understanding, learning, and competent to stand in the king's palace, and to teach them the literature and language of the Chaldeans, which is another word for Babylonians. You find that interchanged in scripture when they talk about the Chaldeans or the Babylonians. It's the same people. Verse 5, the king assigned them a daily portion of the food that the king ate and of the wine that he drank. They were to be educated for 3 years, and at the end of that time, they were to stand before the king. So think about this scenario where Daniel and his buddies are captive. They are in captivity, and yet they have lucked out pretty huge because they have been selected to serve in the court of the king. That means that they get access to what the king has access to. They have the opportunity to eat the very things that the king eats, to drink the things that the king drinks. I mean, look at what is happening here. I mean, this is a pretty, if you're going to be in captivity, I mean, to have favor with the most powerful man in the world is a pretty big deal. I mean, there's how many other people of your race, of your nationality, don't get the very things that these guys are getting? It says in verse 6, among these were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah of the tribe of Judah. Verse 7, and the chief of the eunuchs gave them names, new Babylonian names. Daniel he called Belteshazzar. Hananiah he called Shadrach. Mishael he called Meshach. And Azariah, he called Abednego. It's interesting. Why would the king need to change their names? Why would this need to happen? He wanted these young men kidnapped and brought to him. I mean, these guys are between 12, 15, 16 years old. They're teenage boys. They're the best of the best. They have no physical blemish. They're handsome, they're smart, they're well-educated. It's a very intentional and strategic plan to indoctrinate these young men into the Babylonian culture. Strategic. Because these men, and it's not just them, there's hundreds of them, but these are the ones we find that really stood out in Babylon. I mean, hundreds of them, and they represent the future of a nation that's in captivity. And it's brilliant by King Nebuchadnezzar, because if he can indoctrinate them into the ways of the Babylonian culture, he can remove any opportunity for there to be a future for the Hebrew people. Nebuchadnezzar wanted these young men to think like Babylonians thought. He wanted these young men to behave like Babylonians behaved. He wanted these young men to believe like Babylonians believed. And that's the tension, right? They could have chose to adapt to the culture. Or they could have known who was with them. And they could have chosen to invade the culture. Nothing historic would have been written about these men had they simply blended into the culture. In fact, you could probably say that we may not even have the book of Daniel in our Bible today had these men blended in with culture. Nothing historic, nothing monumental, nothing huge would have been written about these guys had they simply blended in and gone along. And think of how easy it is to justify it. Oh man, I gotta eat. Surely God knows I've gotta eat. I mean, these are my only options here. Surely God knows. I mean, I'm in a pretty tough scenario here. Certainly he would give me some grace to just compromise a little. I mean, doesn't he know, like, I mean, I'll die if I don't. I'd rather be remembered for standing out than forgotten for blending in. And I think that that's the reality that these guys faced. Verse 8, we really find something great happen. But Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine that he drank. Therefore, he asked the chief of the eunuchs to allow him not to defile himself. So we find in verse 8, Daniel makes a decision, right? You can appreciate the tension prior to that. Am I going to adapt or am I going to invade? And Daniel makes a decision. And he says, man, you can change my name. You can give me a new label. You can call me whatever you want to call me. But when you want me to begin to do something that defiles my God and defames his name, I'm going to make a decision to stand out. This is exactly what happens with Daniel. When it was a personal thing, it wasn't that big a deal. You know, I heard this thing, Pastor Brent, I heard this guy, Todd White, speak last Sunday night. He made this interesting statement. He says, it's impossible to offend a humble man. When you think about that, like, I mean, in here, like, they are changing their names. They're changing. All their names were names tied to their God, the God that we all serve today. And the new names they were given were names connected to pagan gods. I mean, imagine, like, just the offense that would build. And you know, how dare you, this and that. But it's impossible to offend a humble man. And what really began to shift and change and rise in them was when they were then asked to do something that would defile their God or defame his name. Verse 17, I'm going to skip down for a second, says this. As for these four youths, God gave them learning and skill in all literature and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. These guys spent 3 years in training, learning the ways and the customs and the culture of the Babylonians. But I am thankful that God had planted some young men in a culture that was godless who would choose to stand up and rise above it and proclaim his name in a place that had no value for their God. So God began to give them favor at the end of the time when the king commanded that they should be brought in. So at the end of the 3 years, the chief of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar, and the king spoke with them. And among all of them, none was found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore, they stood before the king. I mean, picture it, right? It's the end of the 3 years, and they're brought to stand before the king to give an account for what they have learned, to show that they are ready to now serve in the king's court, in a foreign land, in a godless system, before a wicked king. In verse 20, and in every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters that were in all his kingdom. How many of y'all know that there are going to be times in your life where God is going to ask you to submit yourself and to work underneath people who do not share the same values that you share? How many of y'all know there are times in your life God will bring you into a season where you have to submit under somebody that you would even describe as wicked and godless? That puts a lot of tension on your faith, and you have a choice then. You have a choice then on how you will respond and how you will act. And how many of you guys know that these guys showed God, their God, they made him look so good by simply being better, by working hard, by excelling in the things that they were asked to do. It made God look good to this Babylonian wicked king. So the next several chapters, they go on to show some pretty miraculous events that took place, right? But in the midst of their captivity, they held very close to their faith. And you read about these just huge stories in the next several chapters that we're going to unpack in the weeks to come. But the theme that weaves throughout the book is that this is really a template for how to live and how to thrive in a godless culture. I don't see Daniel like creating an uprising. I see a humble man who puts his head down and he serves well. And he waits for his opportunity to make the name of God famous in the land. There are story after story you read in Daniel where the king is out of options and he calls Daniel in, and Daniel does an incredible miracle, and the king Nebuchadnezzar requires that all the people in the land begin to worship the one true God. He waits and he's in waiting. Daniel is waiting for his opportunity to make the name of God famous in the land. And when God taps him on the shoulder, he explodes out of the blocks. We have a choice to be people who bring the culture of where we're from, right? Scripture says that we're citizens of heaven. Scripture tells us that we are citizens of heaven, and we are in a place that provides a culture that is much different than where we are citizens of. We have a choice to bring the culture of where we are from, the culture of heaven, and release it to impact the culture of where we live. I believe that the culture of heaven wants to manifest itself here on earth. Scripture tells us, right, the way Jesus taught us to pray, says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So, he's saying what's already going on up there, what is already happening up there, your will be done. Your kingdom come on earth as it already is in heaven. And so Daniel stayed close to God, and I think it caused him to see some incredible things happen. I just want to share with you a few things that God's doing in my heart and in my life, things he's been stirring in me lately. And it's a unique season, to be honest with you, because God is doing things in me that, activating some things in me, reminding me of things about his nature that I have not remained close to and have maybe not valued the way I should. And I have just felt like God was stirring the pot in my life lately. I've been around, you know, Pastor Brett and Pastor Wes last week, and we've been talking, and man, I can tell you that God is like stirring the pot in them. I've been around our church for These last couple months, especially as I've come in through those doors and I've been in service with you guys, and there have been moments in worship where something has just, you're like, man, you can just sense it. Like we're ready to break out. Like we want God to do something. We don't just want to be some just group. We want to make his name known to the world. And I've just sensed that God is stirring the pot in our church. I've just sensed it. There's been like an unsettledness, like something is brewing. Like, I don't know if you have felt it, and maybe, you know, God just needs to activate your spiritual senses a little bit to begin to sense that God is brewing something here at New Point Church. And I've been praying, God, oh man, God, would you rend the heavens? Would you tear open the heavens and come down, right? Like Isaiah says, you know, God, would you just rip them open and come down and do something great in our midst? And I was in a meeting a couple weeks ago, maybe longer than that, maybe a month or so, and we were talking about how, you know, some ways we could maybe market the church a little better and get our name out there. I mean, it's all good and fine. You know, I like having creative meetings, you know, and things we can do like that. It's good to do that. But we sort of got sidetracked and started talking because like God's stirring something. God's stirring something. We just sort of got sidetracked on this thought. We said, well, man, well, like what if people came in here and life was tough, right? Like life was whatever, I mean, hopeless. Maybe there were marriages that were dissolving and falling apart, right? Maybe they were just people who were sick or whatever. And man, they came in, they were hopeless, life was difficult, and they came in here, man, and this was a group of people who really chased God. And they had a moment, they had an encounter, they had a transformation take place in their life and in their marriage, and things began to just happen. I mean, it's not just stuff that we read about, it's actual stories beginning to happen out of this church. And I just said, man, like, what if stuff like that started to happen? I said, I don't know that we need this huge, right? We were talking, I said, I don't know that we need this huge marketing budget. I said, I wonder if, man, if God would just start to change lives and we'd start to, right? Man, that's what I'm hungry for. I'm all about doing creative, cool stuff, and it's fun to do that. I'm all about just like, God, would you show up? Man, Lord, would you bring your hope to people who are hopeless? Man, God, would you be the ace up the sleeve when the world and every diagnosis and every situation looks bleak and everything looks like a no? God, would you be that ace up the sleeve that can turn things around? And would you bring hope to the hopeless right now here in Urbandale, Iowa? God, would you make your name great? I pray, God, that you would bring people, right, from the north, the south, the east, and the west, that people would come in, that they would meet God, they'd encounter him, and they'd be never the same. That's why we exist. That's why we open our doors, is so that us in here and them out there would have the opportunity to never be the same. And to fall in love with the King of the universe and to watch him do things that use you in ways you could never imagine he'd want to use you. And so I was reading a book over the last couple months. It's called Love, Acceptance, and Forgiveness. It's written by a guy named Jerry Cook. He actually wrote the book over 30 years ago. And he has this line in the book, and he says this. He says it's virtually impossible to feed people who aren't hungry. And I stopped and I looked at that, the words on the page, and it just made my heart ache. Cause I've wondered how many times, man, I've come to church and I've not been hungry for God. And I began to think about this reality. And so what God has done in me over the last couple months, and I have been on my knees, I've been praying for our church, and I've been asking him to stir the pot. I've been saying, God, would you begin to stir in this place just a hunger for you? Would you begin to stir in people? I've been praying for some of you by name, and I've been saying, God, would you just create a hunger in us? Would you create hunger in our church for more of God, right? Because Matthew 5 tells us that blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. And so I was sharing some of this with Pastor Brett and Pastor Wes, and we kind of started dialoguing about this idea. You know, I said, you know, it's one thing if I'm with a group of friends, and we go, we're out, you know, we're hanging out, we're doing something, and I go up to my group of friends, and I say, hey, guys, I'm hungry. Let's get some food, and if none of them are hungry, kind of puts me in a dilemma. And usually what happens is if I'm hungry and no one else is hungry, I end up having to wait until other people are ready to eat. Right? Or I got to go off by myself. I think what happens sometimes in the church is that God begins to do things in people. He begins to rise people up. He begins to create a hunger in them. It's like nothing they've ever experienced before. And they look around them. They're like, are you guys ready to eat? And so many times, like, people just, they're not hungry. And so they sit back down and they wait till other people are ready to go get some food, ready to eat, ready to have more of God in their life. Ready to break out of like a religious routine of just simply coming to church and not doing anything with our faith. And there's a world out there that needs us. There is somebody out there that needs you and needs me to step out so that they could meet Jesus. So we started talking about this idea again. He said, well, how different is it then if I'm hungry and I'm with my buddies, I'm with my friends, and I go out and I say, hey guys, you know, like, I'm hungry. You want to eat? And everyone's like, yeah, I'm hungry. Like, all of us are hungry. Everyone is like, we're starving. Let's go get some food. And when you're in a group of people like that, there's nothing that's going to stop you from finding some food, right? There is now like a compound effect. There is motivation within your group of people to go find some food and figure out where you can find some food. And so I began to wonder, man, God, what would it look like? What could happen? What could take place in this house if we started coming to church and there was like true hunger with inside of us, and you know, you were showing up and you were hungry and you were showing up and you were hungry for more of God, and you were showing up, and then there was just this hunger in you, and there was just this compound effect going on, and people started showing up, and they don't normally come here. They're guests, and they're like, what is up with this place? And they find that all of a sudden, man, God is beginning to set the captives free. He's beginning to heal the sick. He's beginning to empower people to be the ones that he's called them to be. I mean, what would happen if God stirred in us a hunger for more of him? All right, John chapter 3, verse 30, you know, John writes, and he says that you would become greater and that I would become less. That you would increase and I would decrease, right, is what he says there. Man, God, would you begin to increase in this house? God, in every person in this room under the sound of my voice, would you just receive this morning? Every person in this room under the sound of my voice, God, would you just begin to increase in this place? Would you begin to increase in every person's life? More of you and less of us right now. Right now. He's up to something. And it's not about numbers. I really feel like for some of my life, like I'm not motivated by being a church of thousands. I think it'd be cool if God decided to just open up heaven and let us experience something pretty great. But I'm more interested in like being faithful in what he's given us. And I'm more interested in coming together with people who are hungry for God and want to believe that he could do great things again in our day and in our culture. That we could be people like Daniel, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in a place, in a world where people, you know, are godless and wicked and they want nothing to do with God, that somebody would step up and stand out and be a voice, a mouthpiece for the King of Kings. That we would usher in the presence of God through our life. And things would change. It'd be different. And that would be something that you couldn't keep me in bed on a Sunday morning. Couldn't keep me in bed. Jeremiah talks about it. He says, you know, this fire within me, it's like a fire shut up in my bones, right? He says, like, he's saying, like, I can't help it. I can't help but let it out. Even in that point in his life, like, he wanted to keep it in. He wanted, and he couldn't. I've got this video I want you to check out, and, we're going to wind things down here in a moment.
What is an open heaven? We talk about it in church, sing about heaven coming to earth. But honestly, what does this really mean? How do I live with my feet in this world and my eyes fixed on another? have seen the promise of new life. Heard that people can get healed. I've had moments where I've loved beyond myself. But I want more than just a moment, more than just a glimpse. Heaven has already come. God is with us. It's not just a nice thought or theory, but a real experience. What if open heavens aren't places or circumstances or encounters, but me fully convinced of my access to Him at all times? I've come to the end of myself and finally know it's not about my talents or gifts. His world breaking into my world hinges on one simple truth: the awareness of His presence right here and right now. God is not just with me. He is not just near me. God is in me. I embody His presence in my lungs, my bones, my soul. He is fully with me right here and right now, and I owe the world an encounter.
Amen, right? I think God just wants to stir the pot a little bit. I'm reminded that there are layers to God that I have not experienced and that I have not understood yet, right? And usually, you know, we limit like God to our experiences and our understanding and what we can comprehend and what is logical and what is explainable. Well, He's inexplainable. We serve a God who, I mean, it's inexplainable the things He can do. And I just want to be a conduit to land the culture of heaven to earth. That I would be connected to the Father and to His heart. That I would see people who are hurting around me. And I would just show them Jesus. And I would understand that it's not like the video, right? It's not just God with us or God near us, but it's God in us. The hope of glory. Would you stand with me this morning? We're just about out of here. I think I'm doing pretty good when compared to the other guys, right? I mean, I heard some amens. I think sometimes we leave church before God's ready for us to leave. I think sometimes we leave before God has finished what He has started. And just every head bowed in this room right now. I've been sharing some things that are near and dear to my heart. They're things that keep me up at night. They're things that have me unsettled right now. And as I've been sharing with you today and talking to you about this idea of heaven breaking in to your world, into this culture, and you're identifying that you want more of God in your life too, that He would increase in you and that you would decrease, and there is something you're identifying with right now. Say, man, I don't know what it looks like. I don't care what it looks like, but I want God to increase in my life so that He can accomplish through me the things He wants to accomplish. Would you just lift your hand up right now? I just want to pray over you today. Right here, there's hands everywhere. Don't be afraid and don't be shy. There's hands all over this house. I believe that every person in this room, man, right now, under the sound of my voice, God wants to increase in your life in a big, big way. He wants to flow through you. He wants to use you to touch people. He wants to use you to make His name famous in this community, that all people would know that He is the God of the universe. And so, Heavenly Father, right now, I pray that You would just infill us with Your presence,
God, I pray that every person who has raised their hand right now that says, I want more of God, I need more of God, I can't get by without any more of Him, that You would just begin to increase right now, that You would fill up Your people. And God, that we would be filled with courage and boldness to be the people that You've called us to be right now, every person right now here. God, I pray courage and boldness to be the mouthpiece of God that they are called to be in this city. Would You begin to move powerfully in and among them? And we're careful to give You all praise to You, God, in Jesus' name, amen.